1930s Boston. A much feared institution designed to reform young offenders.
Stop there! So tall!
In a unique experiment, 13 young troublemakers.
How many of you have been to an adult jail?
Have volunteered to become Borstal Boys.
Fraud, theft, possession of Class A and Class B drugs, assault.
Were there weapons involved?
Golf clubs.
Banged up for 4 weeks.
Die!
They'll be force-fed fitness.
Mind over matter! I don't mind, and you don't matter!
Discipline.
I will shave, Mr. H.
And hard work.
People in jail don't even have to do this.
In a place where bad behaviour...
You're a scone?
You're the master baker. Oh, certainly not.
And aggression. Meet a brick wall.
Now calm yourself down.
Can the troublemakers of today handle the regime of the past?
Please, I'm begging you, just let me outside.
And will Borstal set them straight?
Security.
Ford Castle, Borstal. 13 young troublemakers, over half with criminal convictions, have been struggling to adapt to the tough regime.
Sit down, Mr. Burnison.
And for some lads, it was all too much.
Man, it freaks me.
The biggest troublemakers were the Kearney brothers.
You are not prototype Cray twins.
Who have both served time for GBH.
Did you use your fists or were there weapons involved?
Weapons.
What sort of weapons?
Golf clubs.
And have been kicking against Borstal rules.
Don't speak to me and I won't speak to you like that. It's simple.
Who the f*** you think she is?
Wakey, wakey, eggs and bakey! 6 a.m. The start of the second week.
Then come up, Benson.
5 minutes!
The Borstal regime was filled with active 15-hour days.
Ah, I love mornings.
Fire up, punch, quick, march!
Made up of work, education and exercise. And for today's residents of Ford Castle, it's no different.
I said from day one, they probably signed up to this because they thought it was a bit of a laugh.
It's going, gentlemen!
But actually, this is really tough.
Keep your noise down!
It's far easier to spend 22 days locked up in your cell, sleeping on your bed, or watching the telly. That's not what happens here.
It's going, keep going, all the way down, keep going. Yes, don't slow down, keep it going. Yes, keep going.
Obviously, I don't enjoy getting up at 6 in the morning and going for a dirty, long-ass 20-mile run.
Keep going.
I'm sorry, shit.
Go! Yes, we are all getting fitter. We love it. Keep going.
I don't even think the 10 months I was away is going to be as challenging as this because, to be honest, it was quite easy where I was.
Straight back! Keep going! Step there, more side.
It started off pretty shit and got a little bit more shit. I've got a funny feeling tomorrow's going to be shit.
The Borstal system was designed to try and prevent young men returning to a life of crime.
Come on, gentlemen! Hurry up!
To achieve this, the regime relied heavily on both punishments and incentives.
Stand up for the governor.
Good morning,
governor.
Please, have a seat. In this Borstal, we believe that we should reward good behaviour and punish bad behaviour. From now on, one of that rewards for individual good behaviour will be this, a blue. If you are awarded a blue, you will automatically have your wages doubled, you will be given extra time in the rec room, and you will not need to go to bed as early as those boys who are not blues. So this is worth winning. Remember, all the rules are there. It's no mystery. So nobody this week should be confused. Thank you, Mr. Dugan.
Stand up, gentlemen!
Oh, I'll be having the moon if I get a blue badge. Over the moon.
It's just a fake little prize to just pacify people, to make them feel a little bit more special.
Well, you keep your head on me, keep it a positive attitude. I reckon I should have a blue by the end of Sunday.
No, lads.
But Craig Kearney and his younger brother Ben's hopes of earning a blue last just 15 minutes.
Dickhead, man.
No. Who's a dickhead?
You.
No,
sit down, please, lads.
I'm sick of it, mate. You think you're a bad man? Lads. All right, we'll see tonight then.
We'll see.
Listen, we'll get together, right?
Well done.
I'll show him a dickhead.
You're going to be on report in a minute. You just heard what the governor said.
Don't start me.
You just heard what the governor said.
Don't care.
fucking little dickhead.
It's your fault, that.
No, it's not his fault.
What, because you used to be like that?
It's not his fault.
You whispered in his ear and have a go with him.
Yeah, I did. I told him to hold his head, but you're bullies.
Yeah, that'll blow your head off, you little f***. I'll snap your chin, you wolf. Because you used to be like that. That's what it was, whispering in his ear. She's a pit. Did you see what she done?
Any excuse that the Keeney brothers can find to cause a ruction in there. And there is fear amongst the lads of these two brothers who appear to be top dog and actually who are really ruining the chances of the other lads.
I don't even give a shit. That all that blue bad shit. I thought, yeah, you know what? I'm going to get one. But I'm not even bothered.
They made some, she's that to me now. I couldn't give a shit about her. She's proper, like, trying to humiliate me. And it's like, my mum wouldn't speak to me like that, so don't you. It's simple as that.
Afternoon, Mr. Duke.
It's the fifth time in the space of just 7 days that the Kearney brothers have been before the governor.
You seem to be having a happy moment, Kearney Major. Why are you happy?
I'm just, in this very moment, I'm quite happy.
And what's made you happy?
Just being here, my brother, and just being
okay. Happy. Let's deal with this matter and get it done with. I cannot let the matron be sworn at. Swearing is against the rules, right? I think that was a yes, wasn't it? Kearney Minor?
I've got a short temper. My temper's on a string like that fin and it just snaps, and if it snaps, I'll go. She doesn't like us, it's clear. Pure and simple.
Matron, is there some issue in terms of you disliking the Kearney brothers?
No, there really isn't. But it's only because you're the loudest and, you know, the ones who do explode. So, you know, you've got a choice to make, yeah? This can be a fresh start, but that means from both of you, keep to the rules, because the only time I tell you off is when you're burping, swearing, or erupting. If that doesn't happen, then it'll be all good.
You have to learn different ways of reacting to situations when you're together. Is that plain?
Yes, Governor.
Let's have this fresh start. Mr. Dugan, take them out.
Thank you, Governor.
Wait outside.
The Kearney's relationship is very, very complicated indeed. We've got to do something with these boys. These boys are being violent in here. And if they're being violent in here, without doubt, they will be violent in the community.
Borstals in the 1930s were self-sustaining. Inmates cleaned the premises, maintained the grounds, grew vegetables and milked cows. The aim? Teach the lads a work ethic and valuable life skills. For the Kearney brothers and other lads, that means running the kitchens.
Hello, Moto.
I don't even know how to turn my mum's oven on, for Christ's sake.
The laundry.
That's disgusting. That's piss on shorts, man. That is nasty.
And even getting their hands dirty on the Borstal farm.
What are we going to do with?
Ah, this is so wrong.
No, I'm not doing that.
A lot of these lads come from really chaotic backgrounds whereby they don't look after themselves, they won't do their washing, they aren't able to cook, they're not able to clean.
Never washed an item of clothing in my life. My girlfriend doesn't let me touch the washing machine.
Why do you keep running after people so that didn't load?
Give me anything down.
Keeping an eye on the lads while they work, Chief Officer Dugan.
My guys, I'll be floating in and out. I'll be around. No pissing about.
In the kitchens, the lads from Shackleton House must cook meals for all Borstal inmates.
Ah, you bastard.
The first time anyone misses about with knives, which I don't think you're going to, a person won't be able to come back in.
With traditional 1930s menus, raw ingredients.
Hello, say hello to my little friend.
Stop playing with the fish, mate.
And antiquated kitchen equipment. For Crabe, it's a culinary journey into the unknown.
I've never made a fish pie nor any other kind of pie. I'm guessing we're just bunging the fish into the pot and hoping for the best.
Yeah, this is the first fish cake, and normally I make like
fish cake,
proper cakes. Or chocolate,
it's not a fish cake, you do.
Chocolate cakes is a pound cake. But this fish there is not going to be a chicken cake now, is it?
No, listen, that's for after you. Tosser. I ain't putting fish in that.
Well, I don't know. That's one of the bastard fish there.
He's making a fish cake.
We're making a fish cake all
you
this time.
You tosser.
Right, Chief. This cake is going to be banging, sir. Banging cake, watch.
At just 18, Zain Rahman is the youngest inmate in Borstal.
Gordon Ramsay, you're out.
Crime is pretty normal in Bradford because people would do it that much, they wouldn't even consider it as being a crime. In the past, I've been charged with handling stolen property and Just minor stuff like that, though, but anything else that I've done, I've just not really been caught for it or anything like that. My look's important to me because it shows and represents who I am. The black gloves, my black gloves, obviously I wear them, so they go well with my outfit. They're just like, it's like the icing on the cake, to be honest, and we just don't leave no prints, do we? No prints.
Take it off.
Oh! Put it up.
It's burnt.
I'll taste it.
It's burnt.
Careful, it's hot.
Have a try.
But it's nice, isn't it? I knew it.
Not like it.
Over in the laundry, spurred on by the prospect of earning a blue, shoplifter Hopwood and the rest of the Livingston lads are working hard. All the lads, that is, except the Kearney brothers.
Push up, please, no. You ready?
I'm f***ing dry.
Fly, lad.
A slow kick. Oh, my ass. Oh, my back.
Gentlemen, right, gentlemen, hurry up.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Chief. Yes, Chief.
It's the end of the working day.
I'm going to be reporting back to Governor. A-star. Thank you to all of you. Brilliant. All right, lads. All right, speak to you later.
See you later. Come here. Come here.
Ignoring the Governor's warning not to swear at Matron,
you now report.
Craig Kearney is sent straight back to see him, while the other lads tuck into the fruits of their labour.
Ready for dinner? Right, take a seat, lads. No worries.
How's the cake?
Delicious.
Nice. I think it's beautiful, honestly.
I think it's a good experience to be, like, experiencing. Yeah, man, I feel banging. 10 out of 10. Feel good.
Good evening, Governor.
Good evening.
Mr. Kearney, Governor. See you on the sudden line. Speak to the Governor. Anyone spoken to?
I now see you more than I see Mr. Dugan in my office. It's like you're wearing a hole in my carpet. And why is he here this evening, Mr. Dugan?
Making unsavoury gestures behind the matron's back, Governor.
Every time you take one step forward, I feel literally you'll take two steps back the next hour. I cannot have been the first person to have said that to you, am I?
No.
No. Okay, Mr. Dugan, one night's isolation away from dorm. Thank you.
Yes, Governor. Can you turn around?
I think of all the boys I've got here, I'm most worried about Kearney. He doesn't seem to be able to learn from his mistakes.
A week into the regime, and discipline is proving to be a challenge.
Kearney, up you get.
To do what?
Yes! Come on, guys! Mind over matter! I don't mind, and you fucking don't matter!
Yes, sir.
Obeying orders is not going down well with former petty criminal Karua.
Karua, hurry up! Don't argue with me!
Kearney, take him off. We'll talk to him at the end.
Every time I keep doing it, I keep hurting my leg. I'm not going to fuck up my leg just to prove fucking some dude wrong.
His repeated non-compliance places him on report. After physical exercise, it's to the canteen for some much-needed sustenance.
My family, right? You get what you're fucking given for dinner.
I'm not in your family.
No,
look,
listen.
At my skin color,
listen
look at
me,
yours.
Right?
We're not in the same family.
I got what I was given for dinner.
However, a diet as plain as it is plentiful is not proving popular.
I'm just getting you some veg.
How the fuck is that the same?
Hopper, why are you swearing?
Because I'm frustrated, Metro.
Yeah, so am I, love.
You said there was vegetables in it, and when you asked the chef said, no, there's no vegetables.
Listen, I told you I saw that they had vegetables in there. Did I say that?
There wasn't vegetables in there, because when you asked the chef told you, to your face, there was no vegetables in there. So say there was no vegetables in it.
You're going to have to come with me.
Fucking come with me. Bitch, mate. You're a fucking idiot. She just actually made me get angry for no reason. For her fucking mistake, she actually pissed me off. She gave me a bowl of soup and said to me, there's vegetables in that. I said, miss, there's nothing. That's just water. She said, no, there's vegetables in that. I said, miss, no, that's water. Fucking divvy bitch. Saying, yes, there is vegetables. No, there fucking weren't.
It's the first visit to the Governor's office for London rioter Valero.
Speaking of spoken to the Governor.
Why are you here?
For discipline.
For discipline? Why do you need discipline?
Because I can't handle the way authority speaks to me. Like, I don't care if you're a judge. You could be sending me to 10 years. I'll call you a...
Sorry.
Mr. Valero, before we go further,
yes.
That's not the kind of language in my office, please. Tell me about the London riots.
I didn't start doing anything wrong until a police officer ran at me for no reason with a baton.
So it was so his fault?
Yeah, it's his fault. I was standing there doing nothing. I weren't mixed in, I had my hood down. As soon as he ran at me with a baton, I changed, I got involved.
In August 2011, Scott Valero was arrested for violent disorder in the London riots.
I was throwing bottles towards police officers. At the time, the adrenaline it was the kick. Well, I'm never going to get arrested for this. Everyone's doing it, joining in. I've joined in, ended up getting arrested and then got in prison for 10 months. I was named and shamed in the local paper. It was quite embarrassing because everyone just instantly now thinks I'm a scumbag, I'm a failure.
So when was your most recent offence?
I was in court the other day.
The other day?
Week. Yeah, the other week. I got arrested for cannabis the other day in court, if you want to be serious. That's all I got charged for. Possession of...
That's okay, is it?
Yeah, in my age, yeah. In more than, what, 8 states, I think, in America, it's illegal in Amsterdam, which is just across, you can get a train there, across the little English Channel. Mm-hmm. It's illegal, it's going to be illegal here soon.
It's legal in Colorado. It's legal in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
It's not legal in Carshalton. And that's where you live. Thank you, Mr. Dugan.
Who the hell are they to speak to me like that? To treat me with respect. You're like, come on. If I saw you out on the road, I'd smash your face in. Like, seriously, just don't do it, man. Don't do it. I wanted to turn around and start smashing the room up then. But it was like, I remember there's cameras on me and I will get arrested for this shit.
With tensions high and continuing flare-ups, the governor is trying a different approach to try and put the boys straight.
I decided to bring in Noel Razor-Smith because he is an ex-offender. He has served most of his life in some form of prison.
Stand up for the government, gentlemen.
So perhaps using his background might actually have an impact on some of the key personalities that are creating tension in this borstal.
So you're called Noel because you were born on Christmas Eve. How did you acquire the name Razor?
When I was a teenager, I was... pretty violent. I was in a gang. I used to carry a cutthroat razor and use it quite regularly on our rivals. It was also quite useful whilst I was in top security jails.
Well, you were known for what type of offending?
Mainly armed robbery, possession of firearms, grievous bodily harm. It would be my job to terrify people into compliance, and I was pretty good at it.
What was it actually made you change your mind, and how come it was that you wanted to stop?
Well, that's a very relevant question. I heard the news that my 19-year-old son outside was dead. I was doing a life sentence. So I went to the governor and asked if I could go to my son's funeral. I begged to go to my son's funeral. But because I'd spent so many years kicking off against the prison system, turning myself into a monster so that they would hate me because I hated them, when I asked for a favour, they took great pleasure in saying no, I couldn't go to my own son's funeral. There used to be an old saying in prison, don't let your time use you, use your time. Do something in order to keep yourself out of jail. Seriously, I ain't just talking bollocks. I'm not just some geezer or some social worker who ain't done it. I've been for it, right? I know what it's like. I know what it leads to. One of these days, you're going to wake up, look in the mirror and think, who's that old geezer? And it's going to be you.
Made me want to cry, man. Like, it was so horrible to hear someone's story like that. It made me think about my life and where I want to be. And I want to go back to jail, man.
After the group session, the governor has lined up a one-on-one with Borstal's top troublemaker, Craig Kearney.
How you doing? Nice to meet you.
Like Razor, Craig has spent time in prison for violent crime, convicted for GBH in 2010.
My mum was crying, so I asked him to come outside. And my brother was waiting as well. We both had golf clubs on us. And he just swung the golf club at him, and a golf club caught him, which damaged his retinas and all his eyes, made him blind in one eye. And then my brother went over while he was on the floor, just started hitting him with the golf club as well. I was sentenced to 3.5 years, and he was sentenced to 2.
Do you think... with hindsight now, looking back, that you've done the right thing, it was the only thing you could do, and you're not sorry?
I don't think I was wrong in what I did. In my eyes, yeah, the woman who brought me into this world, who gave me everything possible. And I regret the fact that I had to go to jail and miss out on 2.5 years of my son's life and my girlfriend's life and everything else I missed out on, but I don't regret what I've done to him.
For a second serious violent offence, you could go to prison for life, you know that, don't you?
Yeah.
And I think you're smart enough to realise, because you're not a stupid person. The family that you love so much and the family that you defended and ended up in prison for, you're not doing them no good if you're stuck in a prison for 15 years, are you?
No.
Do you know what I mean? You realise that this is not, it's not play acting, this is a real experience. I mean,
I understand.
I really hope you do well here, I really do, and I hope you never go to jail again. Use this experience.
Cheers. Thanks for speaking to me. Please. It shit me up a bit. It scared me a bit to think, well, if I carry on the way I am, I'm going to end up like him. I just told myself, you've got to change, and only I can do that. People will help you, but they can only help a certain much. I've got to make that choice. And this stuff Razor, he said to me, will help me as well.
The Borstal boys are taken off-site at least once a week to interact with the local community. The 1930s regime believed it to be impossible to train men for freedom in a condition of total captivity.
These young men don't respond well to boundaries. These lads have the concentration of gnats. We've got to challenge that kind of behaviour. We've got to start introducing the idea of what is appropriate and inappropriate, because that's why they're here. They have behaved inappropriately. They've offended in the community.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As a thank you for allowing the lads to join the congregation, the governor has invited the local vicar to attend a formal dinner at Borstal. With Livingston House in charge of setting up the dining hall, Craig Kearney appears to have turned a corner.
I've actually got to start taking it seriously, not a joke. So I just thought, listen, the whole time, just get my head down, get stuck in, do what I'm asked, get it done. Time will fly, I've got to have no time, and I can make myself a better life when it comes to that time, didn't I?
Over in the kitchens, Shackleton House sets to work cooking dinner.
Borstal and what we're trying to do is not some kind of dirty little secret. I felt it was perfectly appropriate that we should invite them in to see.
We didn't put sugar in, we put salt in.
Oh yeah, I put sugar in.
Bro, that's not sugar, that's salt. No, isn't that salt?
Don't know.
They're not good.
Get some more.
That's piss take, that.
We've got no time to worry about it. Just get them off there and get them about to do it. No messing about.
Oh, fuck's sake.
Yeah.
Today's been stressful.
Yeah, we've got two sweet puddings that ain't cooking, so we have to shove them in the oven. We've got grannies that are beering any second. We've got salty biscuits and, I don't know what the fuck. I don't know what to do myself. I made a little star like that. That can be for the governor. Oh. And he might give me a badge. Oh.
5 p.m. With only an hour to go until dinner, the guests of honour arrive.
We fully fucked it, that's it, we have fucked it.
Guys, the vicar and everyone's already here.
London rioter Valero has been given the special job of welcoming the vicar with a tour of Borstal.
Standing outside the front doors of the entrance to the castle, I feel like a king.
Hello, vicar. Hello, how are you doing?
I'm very good, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
This is the Borstal, if you'd like to come through.
Thank you very much.
I see you.
I see. Your books are shiny.
Oh, thank you. This is where some of the boys do their diaries.
Is it the first time you've been away from your family?
No, it's not. I went to prison in 2011. This is a lot harder though than prison.
Is it?
I'd say yes.
In what ways?
More discipline, more stricter. Absolutely, 100%. Boys would not want to come back.
I see.
I've never been so stressed over a fucking batch of cookies in my life.
In the kitchen, Rahman is trying to keep up momentum.
What are you doing, my man? Are you taking the piss? Well, every time you come round, bro, all you do is fuck about. That's the truth, isn't it? What are you telling me to shut up?
Stop moaning, man.
Bro, you're a dickhead. You come around and fuck about. Obviously, I love a lot when the joke, but there's a fucking time and place, innit? We start taking the piss.
Wilson, man, is pissing about. Pissing about making a joke of everything and that, and then end up shoving a carrot up his ass, me, because I won't shut up. This is where I sleep.
So this is yours?
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Oh, when I'm doing my gardening job, because we have an
very
allotment.
Yeah. Yes, I can see the advantage of that.
Thank you. As you can see on the wall, they are some of the 10 of the rules that we have to abide by.
Committing assault, I'm sure you wouldn't dream of doing that, would you?
No, I would not commit an assault.
Well, if you're pulling faces around my back, bro, I'll headbutt your nose clean off. What? You want to do something? What? No, were you pushing my man? Are you fucked? Bro, he's pissing me off every fucking time, bro. What?
Rahman picks up a knife.
Shut up. Right, move, man. We're going outside, man. We're going outside. Come, let's go outside.
Get the fuck off me, man. Go outside.
Let go.
We'll just go outside. That's it, man. Come. Outside. Oh, showers, man. You're fucking dead, man. You little pussy. All he's done is take the piss. All fucking day he's taking the fucking piss. All
right, listen.
He can't do shit. I'm going to bang him regardless. I'm going to kick fuck out of him in the dorm. Showers anyone. I'm going to fucking eat him up.
Let's get the biscuits done.
I don't want to do no fucking biscuits. I'm off going outside. What do you mean? Nah, fuck that. Fuck that.
You're really
nah,
hot.
Nah, fuck that.
I don't know. Biscuit wars.
Can you fucking smell one? That's messing
up. Now I'm just fucking shaking my adrenaline. The fact that you're keeping me with a knife.
So I've turned around. I'm not having it. So I've told him shut up. So I've just gone for it and just flipped. Stupid. My fault. End off. It's my fault.
Did you have an off in your head?
I did pick it up, sir.
Okay. How you get?
Unaware of the chaos in the kitchen, Valero rounds off his tour with tea in the governor's office.
I'm going to say, it's a very impressive carpet leading up to the governor's desk.
Nice walkway. Very beautiful. Very beautiful.
I'm going there.
Chief Dugan keeps Rahman out of the way to be dealt with later. As the formal dinner gets underway, served by the remaining boys of Shackleton House.
Come on, son, come on!
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, this is very intriguing.
Want some gravy?
It looks as though it could do with a little bit.
A wee bit. Oh, well, there we are.
There you are.
Thank you, Mr. Burns.
Spurgeon, act your age. Gentlemen, stand up.
I enjoyed the experience, but I'm glad to be leaving. I wouldn't like to live like that.
And it went very well, and I heard them speaking about me, and they're speaking very highly of me, and it put a big smile on my face. I ain't glad that someone talk about me like that. Someone that's just met me anyway.
With the vicar and Mrs. Brown safely off site, the governor is finally able to deal with Rahman.
Evening, governor.
Rahman,
come in. Feet on the sideline. Speak when the governor only been spoken to.
You can't pick up a knife and move towards somebody. You know what that means, don't you?
Yeah, that's why I thought it's shirt down, sir.
It's incredibly serious, Rahman. You do understand that, don't you?
Yes, sir. I don't know what went through my mind, but I did realise, like, pretty quick compared to what I, like, before. Like, I wouldn't have stopped, but, like, now I have.
I am incredibly disappointed. That line is a serious line that you've crossed.
Yeah, it is, sir.
And as a consequence of crossing that line, I am no longer prepared for you to remain in the borstal. Do you understand what I've said?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Dugan.
Hey, Governor. Round the turn. This way.
My own feeling is of surprise because of all the people that I might have thought would be prepared to behave in that way. I wouldn't necessarily have picked Rahman.
I'm not from the roughest of places, but things like this happen every other weekend. Like, you hear someone's got stabbed or something, or someone's got shot or something. It's just one of those things. That's why I didn't really see it too bad, but then it sinked in. Like, not everyone's from my hometown. But yeah, like, from anyone else's eyes, obviously, I'm seen as a proper threat. And I understand that. I'm just fully disappointed in myself. It was probably one of the best opportunities I've had in my life, and things like this don't come around every day. But just by doing something so stupid, it's just all gone. Everything's just, yeah, it's gone.
Next morning, the governor calls the boys to account, handing out rewards and punishments.
Gentlemen, stand up for the governor!
Thank you very much. Please sit down. Clearly, there's somebody missing, and that person's obviously Rahman. So let me make it quite plain. We cannot have any type of violence in this borstal. So Rahman has gone and we move on. And in particular, how we move on today is that we are going to talk about the camping trip that happens this evening. So everybody whose name I read out next will not be going on the camp. Kearney Major, Karuwo, and Burniston. If you think it's totally unfair that you have not been chosen, tough. The rest of you will be going on the camp. Everybody clear? Thank you, Mr. Dugan.
Stand up!
Why is he not allowed to go?
If they had to take one brother over the other, it should have been me. When it's come to conflict between other lads and threats and swear words, and I think we both agreed he's been the worst brother.
Guys, you've got 2 minutes.
I'm quite excited. I weren't expecting to go, to be honest. I thought, as soon as he said three people, I thought there's me, Craig and Berniston gone. And I was quite surprised he never mentioned me, so I'm happy.
Slightly pissed off because the governor's, you know, backstabbed me, but overall not that fussed. I'm not here to please the governor, you know, I'm here to do my time and then go home.
Let's go!
I'm not really bothered about not going camping, no. I think it is because of fire in Craig's face, yeah.
Just an idiot.
While Craig Kearney, Berniston and Karuo are set to work at Borstal, the other lads start their hike to camp.
I've consciously tried to separate the Kearney brothers because I've got this sense that when they are together, they're kind of combustible, they're kind of corrosive, and therefore, if I start to separate them, it just allows them to see how their lives might take very different paths if they try to manage their relationship in ways that they haven't previously.
The lads have all been given maps and must navigate their way to camp.
To be honest, he hates long distance stuff. He'd be moaning like a little girl now. And he gets stressed easier than me anyway. So I don't think it would have been ideal.
Camp was a treat for boys who had performed consistently well during their stay.
Ah, shit.
Lost. The map's fucking shit. And I don't have a fucking compass. And I'm outside of Aberdeenshire. That's the problem.
Balls.
Come on, lads.
5 p.m. The first group of lads arrive at base camp.
Where are they hiding?
They're not.
Are we first one?
Yes.
Back at Borstal, Craig Kearney is putting his disappointment at missing camp to good use.
None of the lads, you know, imagine, they're all having a scream, no matter, do you know what I mean? There's nothing better when you're a kid going out clean, coming in filthy. I'd sort of mention I was on it, but at least now here, I can actually show my skills as a single person instead of me and Ben all being together, show the real side to me, and get my head down, and maybe get some positives for myself out of it.
Nearly lost my eyeball.
7 p.m. The last lads arrive.
2 hours behind us! 2 hours!
Yeah, please.
Well done, boys.
Yeah, oh, these really got pretty lost as soon as we crossed the river. We went clean off the map, sir.
Well, gentlemen, instead of talking, I'll get you some shelter.
With all of Livingston House at camp, back at Borstal, Craig Kearney settles down for a night alone in his dorm.
We ain't been on the own, so you still have no lads around. And if the lads aren't there, I guarantee they'll always have Ben. But I just got at it with a positive frame of mind, then moan at it, I couldn't go. Done all the work Majin asked me to do, cleaned up the dorm. I'm aiming to get a blue badge, double money, double canteen. Try and get that by Sunday. That's my aim.
Every fucking thing we do is...
Language, Mr. Henry.
What are you doing? Sorry?
Language.
Get the fuck.
The 1930s Borstal system had no merit without its staff. It was firmly believed that it was men and not buildings who would change the hearts and ways of misguided lads.
When I went to prison, it was the scariest moment of my life. I was 15 and I was going in with loads of with murderers, with rapists, with stuff. I didn't know what the hell was going on around me. It took me about a month to settle in. I've been in care since I was 8, up until I come out of jail. That's what I want to do. I would like to be a care worker. You say the best people for it are the people that have experienced it. And 10 years experience is enough for me, to say the least, to know how to see a lad struggling, how to know when a lad's down, how to know when he's happy, you know, just to spot emotions on its own is good enough. I think, like, without blowing my own trumpet, I'd be really good at that.
We're seeing a different side of Ben Kearney tonight. He has actually come out of his shell, and that's probably because he's away from what could be seen as a negative influence, his brother Craig.
I'm going to take a lot away from here. I met a good group of lads.
So you think this is, so far, an up and down but positive experience?
Yeah, definitely. A lot more to come as well.
Yeah, good. Today, all in all, has been a very successful camp.
Come on, Mr. Come on,
good morning, you sleeping beauties.
It's your name, not your
Come on, guys, come on! Keep going!
This is not easy, man.
Gentlemen, hurry up, or we will start the PT lesson again! Hurry up!
It's the end of the week.
Good morning, Mr. Burniston. How are you?
Fine, boy.
Good.
And all the lads are looking forward to finding out who has been awarded a blue.
If I get the recognition and a blue badge this week, I'll be smiling. I'll be over the moon. You'll see me dancing. I'll probably give a little shuffle.
Championship was a big success, so I think I do deserve one.
I've actually put 100% in over the last two or three days, so hopefully they've recognised that, seen how I put effort in, and hopefully I'll get one of them blue badges.
Stand up for the governor.
Good afternoon, have a seat please. When you signed up for this, as I keep pointing out, you must have thought it was going to be a bit of a laugh. And now you're realising it's tough. But right now, as well as announcing the best performing boy of the week, I will be awarding blue badges to those of you who have shown exceptional progress. I was particularly impressed by the formal dinner that we had and the meal that was produced for that formal dinner. An incredibly successful orienteering and camping trip, but also Burniston, Carawar and Major performed incredibly well when they were left behind in the Borstal. Therefore, the first blue will go to...
Who was that?
Me.
Get outside, now.
It is simply not socially acceptable to do that. However, despite that, the first blue will be to Crabe. The next blue will be to Hopwood. And the final blue for this week, and the best performing boy of the week, will go to somebody who I felt challenged authority every time he came in front of an authority figure. And yet, this person has been able to start changing his attitudes towards people, towards his circumstances, and this person was able to host outsiders to this Borstal in a way that they were totally, utterly captivated. And so the best performing boy of the week and the final blue will go to Valero. Can I remind the three blues, your wages are doubled and you will be given access to the games room every night until 9:30. Thank you.
Stand up, gentlemen.
I'm happy, really happy. I got a blue and I won the best performer, well, best student of the week, basically, whatever they want to call it. I feel amazing. It's brung my spirit even higher this week. It's just getting better and better for me.
Shows that I'm a blue.
To be fair, the blue I weren't really bothered about, which comes like, obviously, the pay rise and staying up late doesn't appeal to me anyway, because I'd rather go to sleep at 9 o'clock, because that's when I'm really tired.
I weren't expecting no blue. I was hoping I'd get one, but I didn't expect it. So I'm not really taking anything from it. Each day as it comes, I'm just going to think positive and crack through it. I ain't really bothered about not getting a blue this week, because I'll have one next week.
Down.
Next time.
Not in a fresh, is it?
A new arrival causes tensions.
Get your socks off now. Okay, get outside.
We've already had 3 hard weeks. We don't want your making this last one any harder.
Yeah.
Burniston revolts.
I ain't doing this. I'm refusing to shovel shit, Governor.
Why'd you think that?
And the Kearney brothers reach breaking point.
He's throwing first punch at me, so I'll make sure I throw the last. I guarantee it.